welcome back to my YouTube channel. I hope you all are doing well. So in my last video, we have discussed types of rental options available in Singapore. So if you want to understand more about what are the different types of houses available for rent in Singapore and what are their differences, so I would highly recommend you to watch that video. I will put the link in the description box below so you can check it out later, and it will be really, really helpful for you to decide better. And for today's video, we are going to talk about how to find or search a house in Singapore. So before I begin, please take a moment to hit like, share and subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon. And now let's get started. So as we all know that renting an apartment can be really tough and tiring, especially for the ones who are new to this country. You have to have patience and you need to check out different options at various locations to find out which is going to be your home. So guys, I have been renting for years now at different places being an expat. So this video comes from the experience and the knowledge I have and the mistakes I have made or have seen others making. So please watch it till the end. I'm sure it's going to be really helpful. So now the question comes, what are the factors we need to consider while searching a flat? So I would say to each their own, because it completely depends on your needs and your idea of living. But there are some important factors which will help you decide and are common to everyone. Like, how many rooms do you need? What is the transport connectivity? What is the location? I mean the preferred location. What is the budget? How much is the travel time, you know, for your kids to go to their schools and for yourself to go to your workplace? Where is the nearby essential market area, like for your daily needs? Any nearby facility? Anything related to recreational activities, if in case that's one of your needs? So yeah, it depends on lot many factors. So these are the things which you have to keep in mind in order to make a better decision. So now the question comes, how to find a house or a room in Singapore? Basically, what is the process to start with? There are two kind of services. One is the paid service, the other one is the free service. The paid service is through local brokers and agents. And the free services includes the websites which I am linking down below in the description box. You can check them out. And the second one under the free service is the social media, basically Facebook groups. So these are the two types of services which will help you in reaching out to the right people. So these websites will have listings directly from the owners who are willing to rent their houses, as well as from the agents. So it's your choice whether you want to contact the owner directly and walk in and see the place, or you want to explore through agent and take his help. So now if you have decided to go through an agent, there are a couple of things which you need to keep in mind. Please verify agent's CEA registration number online. I am going to put the link in the description box below, so you can check that out later. So CEA stands for Council of Estate Agencies, and it's an authorized agency which authorizes the agents, right? So you are in good hands, and this works best for the people who are searching their houses and contacting agents remotely. So that helps. So another important thing which you need to be careful about is that agents don't charge from both the parties. So let's say an owner has hired an agent. So agent is supposed to charge only the owner and not the tenant. Likewise, if tenant has hired an agent, so agent will only charge the tenant. So please be careful, and it should never be both ways. Well, how much do an agent charge? Most of the agents, they charge from 15 days to 1 month house rent. Depends on the conversation you have with them in the beginning. So it's negotiable, but you have to have that clarity that how much are they going to charge. So ask. Another thing which I want you to highlight in the conversation with them is how many houses are they going to show you under the fees they are charging. So in my experience, my agent said that I'm going to show you only 7 houses, and if you go beyond that, then you might have to pay extra. So please clarify this while finalizing your agent. So another mistake which people make is not seeing the flat and signing the lease remotely. I understand that it saves some kind of an effort, but guys, I cannot stress enough on that. Please see the apartment or the house you have finalized by yourself and see if you are comfortable, because it's definitely gonna save a lot of trouble in the future. So if I have to give you one important tip in the entire house renting process, that would be, please don't be scared or afraid in asking questions. It doesn't mean that you have to annoy the agent or the owner, but ask as many questions as you want. If you have any concerns or questions in mind or any preferences, so just ask it out, because the more you ask, the more clarity you'll get, and it will help you stay longer in that one place. Once you find the home of your dream, now what? Moving in? Well, here comes the contract. So you have to read it very, very carefully and understand the expectations from you by the owner. And it's a very important part of this entire process, and be very careful. So how much is the deposit? Well, most of the times for both HDB and condos, it's 1 month house rent, which is refundable. At times it can be 15 days also, but it depends on the conversation you have with the owners. But most of the times it's 1 month house rent, but it is subject to deductions if you have not behaved properly in the house. They will verify everything when you leave the house. They are going to deduct if, suppose, you have spoiled the walls or if something is broken. So they are gonna deduct that particular amount from the deposit. Otherwise, it's all refundable. Next up is inventory checklist. Once you have finalized the house, a copy of inventory checklist is always given to you by the agent or the owner. So if not, then please ask for it, because it's a very important document. It is basically the list of all the items which are coming along with the house, including the size, quantity, type, brand, how many keys are there, you know, how many drawer keys, how many duplicate or spare keys. So basically everything. So one tip is, please verify the entire checklist which is handed over to you with the physical items and see if there are any discrepancies and point it out right there in front of the owner or the agent before signing the lease. I know you must be thinking that how is it even practically possible to check all the items, verify all the corners in the house, but for that there is a clause in most of the contracts saying that you will get a 30 days grace period to report any existing damage and the owner should be able to fix it. But if you fail to report any existing damage in those 30 days, then it will all come on you and it has to be paid by you. So this clause is available in most of the contract, but it's not mandatory. So you have to check with your owner that if you have that clause in your contract or not. Another important point which you need to look for in the contract is the utilities. So is it going to be included in your rent or you have to pay separately, because that really counts on your budget. So you have to be really, really clear about how are you going to pay the utilities. And by utilities, I mean gas, water and electricity. Apart from this, we have AC maintenance also, and it should be listed in the contract as well. So please look for that. AC is supposed to be maintained by the tenant every quarterly, and most of the time you are expected to send the receipt of the repair or the maintenance to the owners. Next up is the parking. You have to analyze the entire parking situation in that building or the condo you are planning to stay. There's a tip, you guys, that most condo comes with a free parking space. So you don't have to pay anything extra for the parking if you are renting the entire house. So if your contract says that, you know, you have to pay extra for the parking space, you can always go back and negotiate with your owner on the same, because most of the times it comes with free parking. Next is, can I make changes to the house as per my need? Well, the answer is no, and it's a part of your contract. So most owners don't approve for any kind of structural alterations. Maybe if you want to paint a wall or put a nail and hang a bookshelf or something like that, it's not allowed, guys. But if you need any extra fittings, let's say a pair of curtain or a fan or a TV, you can still go back to your owner and negotiate and see if he can accommodate this without charging you anything extra. Another thing which you should watch out in your contract is about minor repairs. So minor repairs includes replacement of light bulbs, tubes, replacement of any parts. So for all such repairs, the tenant has to pay the cost up to $100 per item. And for cases where the cost exceeds more than 100, then the tenant is supposed to pay the first 100 and the rest will be paid by the owner. But in such cases, you have to inform the owner before going ahead with the repair. Apart from this, there are contracts where the tenant has to pay up to the cost of $150 per item instead of $100. So you have to check your contract and see how it is for you. Coming to internet access. Well guys, I don't have to tell you the importance of having internet at home, especially in these times, and otherwise also, unless you are on some holidays or sitting in some mountains having no phone policy. That's a different thing, but it is very essential and you need it. So things to check. Number one, if internet is included in your rent. Number two, if it's ready to use. look for the ports or the broadband or optical fiber outlets and see if they are ready to use. Otherwise, if there is no internet connection, please request it around 15 to 20 days in advance with some private vendors. We have like multiple options here available for the connections. So you can request for the connections beforehand, and you know, you can even trace the status of your connection request. Just have to go to the website and type in your address and you can check out your status. So these are the things which you need to ensure that it's taken care instead of just landing up in a house with no internet. Next up is guest policy. So guys, we all have guests as friends or relatives, so guests are allowed. That's not the question. The question here to ask is how many guests at one time and how long can they stay? Plus, if there are any additional charges which you need to pay and in what circumstances. So these are the things which you need to be aware of, because since it's a rented place, it's not your house, you have to check either in your contract or with the owner. Next thing you should check if cooking allowed or not. Guys, Singapore is a multiracial country and you have people all across the globe here. And everyone has their own preferences and different type of cooking they would like to have. So whenever you are searching a house, maybe through a website or through an agent, and when you have these advertisements in the website, look for the type of cooking they have mentioned. So if they have mentioned light cooking and if you are okay with it, please go for it. If they are mentioning no cooking allowed and if you are okay with it, please go for it. But if you are someone like me who wants to have an elaborate cooking, then in that case, light cooking is not for you. Light cooking mainly means boiling eggs or noodles or something which is quicker. So if you are someone who eats out most of the time and you know, you don't end up cooking so much at home, then I think light cooking works perfectly fine for you. You can just go for it. But for me personally, I am an Indian and I love home-cooked Indian food. And I cook every day, okay, almost. So I wanted to have a place where I can cook anytime, whenever I want, however I like. So it's totally your choice and your preferences. Coming to subletting. So what is subletting? Let me give you an example. So let's say you have rented the entire house and it has two bedrooms. And one bedroom is occupied by you and the other one is free. So what you tend to do is to give that other room to someone else on rent. Now, is it allowed? For that, you have to check your contract and see the subletting clause. If it says no subletting allowed, that means you cannot do it. If it says subletting allowed, and if you're willing to sublet a part of your house to someone, then how to go about it? So first of all, you have to inform your owner, even if it's written in your contract that subletting is allowed, but please inform your owner. He should know that who else is living in his house, right? So another thing which you have to do is to update the contract by this new person's name along with your name. So when you first had signed the contract, it just had your name, right? So now you have to add his name and his details along with his PIN number and NRIC and stuff to the contract and get the contract updated. And that's how you legally sublet. But let's say if your contract says subletting is not allowed and you still have subletted a part of your house to someone. So guys, you cannot just let anyone secretly staying up in your house without having it documented on the contract and having permission from the owner. So don't do that. That's illegal. Coming to renewal or extension of lease. So let's say your lease is coming to an end and you have decided to continue staying in the same place. Then in that case, please check your contract and see how many days or how many months before the owner is expecting you to inform him. So please inform your owner beforehand to avoid the trouble and the confusion, because he would assume that you will be vacating the house on so and so date and he would start looking for new tenants accordingly. Another thing is, whenever you are renewing the contract, in most cases they might renew your rent amount as well. So you have to have a discussion about that and see what is the new rent amount, and your deposit will be based on your new revised rent. So here are some tips for you guys. If you are moving into a condo and if your shipment is arriving through a shipment agency, let's say Movers or Packers, or there are many other, then in that case you cannot just call the shipment truck directly to your condo. You have to take a special permission from the condo leasing office, and you can ask your owner to contact them, or you can contact them directly and tell them that this will be the size of the truck and this will be the specifications, and then on the basis of that they will provide you a time slot wherein you can call that particular shipment truck to the condo. This is for the convenience of the residents as well, so you cannot directly call your shipment truck anytime in the condo. I have not seen this case for HDBs, but I have experience this in condos, so take a note on that. So another tip is, please take photos or videos of the entire house, I would say, including the walls, the balconies, the lampshades, the items listed in the copy of inventory checklist which is given to you in the beginning. So everything, you know, washrooms, because this will serve as a reference point when you leave the house. So when you plan to leave the house before you move out, the agent and the owner, they will come for inspection, and if they find any difference in the condition of the items given to you, basically the entire house, then they will deduct the maintenance and repair costs from your deposit amount. So if you have some reference point, then it will save up a lot of money. So last but not the least, utilities connection. Before you move into a house, please make sure that you have all the connections in place, and if not, please request for connections well in advance, otherwise it will be a lot of trouble. I think it usually takes around 15 to 20 days once you request for the connection, and once you decide that you have to move out of that place, or maybe you are shifting to a new place and leaving this house, please ensure to request for cancellation for all the utilities as well as for internet, otherwise it will keep charging on your card. So that's it for the video, guys. I hope you like it. Thank you so much for watching, and let me know in the comments below if you have any other questions, or if this video was helpful, or if you have any other suggestions for my upcoming videos, let me know. Please hit like, share and subscribe to my channel, and follow me on Instagram, and I will see you in my next video. Bye!